Hello there, and thank you for joining us in this new Azure Portal how-to video. Today, we'll learn how to create a storage account with the Azure Portal, and we have Misha there with us that is going to show us how to do that. So thank you very much for joining us today, Misha.
Thank you so much for having me, Leon. I'm really excited to be here. We have a great demo planned, and we're going to walk customers through how to create a storage account in the Azure Portal.
That's fantastic. Look forward to see it. Let's go.
Great. First, we need to select Create a Resource, since that's what we're doing. Then, we click Create under Storage Account to launch the Storage Account Create. So once this loads, we'll start out in the Basics tab by specifying the subscription, the resource group, and the name of the storage account. The name of your storage account needs to be unique and can only contain lowercase letters and numbers. Here's a name for our storage account today. Next, you'll need to select the region where you'd like your storage account to be located. Azure Storage is supported in a variety of regions around the world. But for today, let's stick with East US. Next, we'll need to make some decisions about the type of storage account we want. First, we need to decide whether we want standard or premium performance. Standard accounts are backed by hard disk drives in our data centers and are ideal for the majority of customer scenarios. In a standard general purpose V2 account, you'll have access to all four of the storage sub-resources: blobs, files, tables, and queues. By contrast, premium accounts are backed by solid state disk drives and are meant for low latency scenarios. Premium performance can be applied only to the blob service or to the file service. And you'll need to specify which one will be backed by premium performance when you create your account. We do not support premium performance for tables and queues at this time. For today, let's go with the standard account. The last decision you need to make here is the level of redundancy we desire for the data in our account. Azure provides an array of redundancy options, and we provide guidance on which one you might need. Locally redundant storage is the most affordable option and provides strong resiliency against hardware failures. Geo-redundant storage is great for failover scenarios and allows you to have a backup of your account in a different Azure region. Zone-redundant storage offers strong protection within a single Azure region and is recommended for high availability scenarios. Geo-zone-redundant storage combines the offerings of both GRS and ZRS and is the optimal data protection solution. Lastly, both geo-redundant storage options allow the customer to enable read access to data in the storage account in the event of regional unavailability, perhaps caused by a natural disaster or power grid failure. Let's keep it simple today and utilize locally redundant storage. Now we can move to the Advanced tab. Here, we can configure key security settings for the storage account, as well as settings specific to the blobs and file services. We generally recommend leaving the security settings in their default state unless your scenario specifically calls for an exception. These settings will help you utilize your data in your account effectively while keeping it secure. If you are looking for data lake features, specifically Azure Data Lake Storage Gen 2, this is where you can enable it. Check the box, and your account will have a hierarchical namespace for your blob storage with ADLS Gen 2 capabilities. A hierarchical namespace, or HNS, is a prerequisite for utilizing SFTP and NFS V3 for blob storage. Next, specify the default access tier for your blob storage. We recommend sticking with hot storage unless you're specifically looking to fulfill a backup scenario. Lastly, decide whether you need large file shares for your file storage. This setting allows your file shares to scale up to 100 terabytes. This only applies to standard file shares, as all premium file shares scale up to that threshold. Next, we move to the networking tab. This is where we can define network access to the storage account. You can choose to utilize the public endpoint associated with the storage account to allow access from all networks, from a specific set of virtual networks. And you can add the virtual network here along with the subnet. Or you can disable the public endpoint entirely and utilize a private endpoint for the most secure connection. For today, let's allow access from all networks. You also have the option to decide how traffic is routed to your storage account. We recommend using Microsoft Network Routing. This option takes full advantage of Azure's resilient networking capabilities and prioritizes using the Azure network to transmit your data securely. Internet routing will keep your data out of the secure Azure network and on the public internet until the last possible moment. All the settings on this tab can be modified at any time once you've created your storage account. So let's go to data protection next. Here we configure settings that allow you to protect your data from accidental deletion or modification, or manage versions of your blob data and track changes to it. Soft delete settings for blobs, containers, and file shares are on by default and provide basic protection from accidental deletions. You can adjust the retention period to fit your needs. We'll stick with 7 days for this account. For the strongest protection for your blob storage, you can enable point in time restore. This will allow you to restore any container in your account to a previous state. The settings mentioned previously, soft delete for blobs, containers, and versioning, along with change feed for blobs, which keeps track of blob creation, modification, and deletion in your account, are all prerequisites for point in time restore. Lastly, you can opt into support for version level immutability. If you want to be able to specify default immutability policies on your data at an account level, you can opt into that here. As with the networking tab, all the settings on this tab can be modified at any time once you've created your storage account. Next, we have the option to specify encryption settings. The data in your storage account will remain encrypted regardless of which setting you choose here. However, you do have the option to let Microsoft manage your encryption key or to do it yourself. If you do choose to manage your own keys, you'll also need to determine the scope of those keys, blobs and files, or to all services. You will also need to either have a key vault and a key to use to secure your account that you can link here directly, or you will have to have the key URI handy to paste in here. Regardless of which option you choose for encryption key, you'll need to assign a user-assigned identity. This user-assigned identity will help you provide access to other resources. We'll keep it simple and go with Microsoft Managed Encryption today. Lastly, if you need a second layer of encryption at the hardware level, you can choose to enable infrastructure encryption with this option here. And again, all of these settings can be updated once you've created your storage account. Now, on the Tags tab, you can set any tags that you would like. And once you're satisfied here, we can move on to review and create. Here, we check for validation. Great, it passed. And this is an opportunity to review what we plan to deploy. If we notice any mistakes, it's easy to go back and make any edits. But I'm happy with what we have here. Now we just need to hit deploy. So let's click create. The deployment has been submitted and it's now in progress. And we just need to wait for the storage account to deploy. If in your storage account create, you added any additional resources, for example, a virtual network or a private endpoint, those will also deploy as part of this process here. Once it finishes, we'll get a notification as well as a button that we can click right there to go and view our new storage account. At this point, the storage account has been created. You can manage account settings, manage your data, connect to it, and perform any other task you might need to do here.
Thank you very much, Misha. That was a great and detailed explanation, and I learned a lot from it. Please try it out. Let us know what you think. Leave us a comment in the comment section. We have a next video featuring Misha as well, where he's going to teach us how to manage storage accounts using the Azure portal. So please, I would love to see you there. So look forward to seeing you in that next video. Bye for now.